Pastor Kerry is coming to bring the word tonight. Joshua chapter 3. Right. Will you give him a warm welcome?
Am I on here?
Love you,
all
Kerry.
Right. We're coming to the end of what hopefully has been a great day for all of you. And as any other day, a lot of things have happened, but I still believe that, in fact, I'm certain of it, that all of you can remember the first thing that you did this morning. Maybe not the exact thing or the sequence of things, but in general, after you got up, what did you do? No, open your eyes. What'd you do before you come to church? You got ready. You got ready. We do it every day. That's the routine. We know it. And after church, when you got home, or maybe before you got home, what did you do soon after that? You had lunch. Now, did that lunch just magically appear on the plate in front of you? I know some of the men here probably think that's it happened, something like that. But how did it get there? Somebody made it. Somebody prepared it, right? Now, those may not be that big a deal, but in the course of a day, those are important things, getting ready and eating. But anything of significance in life takes some form of preparation. In fact, some of them may be more than others, but whether it's just getting ready for school or work or whatever, maybe something a little more important like a job interview or a test or planning for vacation, or even life-type events like having a child or saving for college or planning for retirement. To get the most out of anything, we need to prepare or be prepared. So with all the prep that's going on in our lives, I have to wonder why it is that sometimes we approach God's plans, which far supersede anything that we could have on our agenda, why we approach those things, whether they're plans he has for me specifically for this day or for the foreseeable future, why we approach those things with eternal significance with sometimes less intentionality than we do some of our daily routines. You know, I think of the fact that get to Joshua chapter 3. We're going to get there in just a second. But God in this passage was calling his people to get ready. Now, we've already been kind of ahead of this place, and we've seen God doing some powerful things. But this comes before all that because God is saying, I'm going to do some stuff, but you need to get ready for that. That's what's going on in our passage tonight. And I wonder sometimes when it comes to God's things, if we take the attitude, well, that doesn't really require anything for me. God's going to do what he's going to do with or without me, and I'm going to go on my way of life, and God's going to accomplish the things he wants to, and if he wants me to have some input and involvement, he'll let me know, right? Well, he's been pretty clear in his word that the way he intends to accomplish his purposes is by partnering with us. And that's what he told his people in this passage. I'm going to do some amazing things, but I want you to get ready for it. So turn to Joshua chapter 3. The Israelites are standing here at the threshold of the promised land, and that phrase comes up all kinds of ways in cultural context throughout history. This is where it came from. This is the original land of promise, the place that God told Abraham his descendants would one day inhabit. And so for the children of Israel, who were descendants of Jacob, Abraham's grandson, who God later renamed Israel, this really is the culmination, the redemption really of centuries of hardship and oppression, and more recently from decades of waiting and wandering and wondering if they would ever get back to this place because they had been there before. Remember when they came out of Egypt and they'd been at the brink of entering the promised land, but they refused to trust that God was going to help them overcome the giants there? And because they lacked that faith in God, they were consigned to wander for another 40 years in the desert until that generation had passed away. But here they are again, and this time, I think they're ready to take God at his word. So in Joshua chapter 3, verse 1, let's begin reading. Early in the morning, Joshua and all the Israelites set out for Shittim and went to the Jordan where they camped before crossing over. After 3 days, the officers went through the camp giving orders to the people. When you see the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord your God and the priests who are Levites carrying it, you are to move out from your positions and follow it. Now, what did the Ark represent or contain? The presence of God, yeah. And so they're following the presence of God. It says, but keep a distance of about 1,000 yards between you and the ark. Do not go near it. Now, The next verse is what I want to hone in on. It's one of those passages you could easily overlook on the way to get to the real action and adventure. And there's a lot of that going on in Joshua. But before all that happens, something just as important, if not more so, needed to take place. And that's what Joshua told the people in verse number 5. He says, "Consecrate yourselves, for tomorrow the Lord will do amazing things among you." And Joshua said to the priest, "Take up the ark now, the covenant, and pass on ahead of the people." So they took it up and went ahead of them. Consecrate yourselves, for tomorrow the Lord will do amazing things among you. Let's pray. Lord, I thank you that as we serve you, our best days are never behind us. You've always got things in store for us. You've got plans and purposes. And God, you want us to be right in the middle of them because that's how you've chosen to fulfill those things. And God, I ask tonight, though, that you would prepare us to take part in those things. You would prepare us for what you have in store for us. And Lord, for a lost and dying world that you are calling us to reach. And Lord, give us a heart to hear your word tonight and to respond accordingly. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, God's people had come a long ways to get to this point, and everything that they anticipated and hoped for was just about to unfold. And God said, "Get ready." And my challenge to you as God's people today is we need to get ready for what's ahead. Now, I don't know what all that's going to entail. It's probably going to be a mix of both victory and struggle because God promises that's what's going to face his people as they follow him in an ungodly world. And surprising to some people, both trials and triumphs require a similar form of preparation because often they go hand in hand because after all, that's how victory comes from enduring and overcoming tough times. So just like the people in Joshua's time, we need to get ready for what God is about to do if we want to be a part of it. Because experiencing the fulfillment of a promise, just like Austin talked about a couple weeks ago, before venturing into new opportunities, before we reclaim territory for God's purposes, the legacy we leave is going to depend on how we prepare today. And that's why the first instruction that God gave before crossing the river was for the people to consecrate themselves, because from that point on, God was going to begin to do some pretty amazing things. So he says to consecrate yourselves, for tomorrow I'm going to do amazing things among you. Now, to consecrate, it may be one of those kind of heavy sounding, deep theological terms, and it really simply means to separate or to come away from anything that's unholy and unpure so we can devote ourselves completely to God's purposes. And it really points to the principle that God is not going to act powerfully on behalf of people who are not aligned with his promises and his purposes. In fact, we can't expect God to do all kinds of signs and wonders unless our hearts are pure and our desires are in line with his Holy Spirit. So he tells us that we need to consecrate ourselves, and that's why throughout his word, he calls his people to be holy, or sometimes, particularly in the New Testament, the word sanctified is used. It's the same concept, and again, it simply means to be set apart for God's purposes. And that involves both separation and preparation. Separation from sin and wickedness and worldly ideals and things, and dedication unto God's purpose. So separation from sin and devotion to God. That's the purpose that he's calling them to. Now, part of that preparation is what God's Holy Spirit is already doing in us. That's the most important part. But a significant part of that also involves us keeping our own heart and lives in a condition where God can use us as he chooses. So I want to briefly consider and highlight four aspects of consecration that need to characterize our lives in order to be ready for what God wants to do in and through us. Four aspects of consecration. And the first one is purpose. We are set apart for a purpose, because consecration and holiness are not just about what you avoid, they're about what you pursue. What you're going after, that implies a purpose. The Bible often refers to people or sometimes things as holy or being made holy, but not because certain things are just inherently more pure or holy than other things, because there are a lot of very simple, ordinary, plain, unimpressive things in Scripture, both objects and individuals that were made holy in the sense that they were plucked from their common surroundings, they were purified or cleansed in some fashion, and then they were commissioned for God's purposes. They didn't have to be pretty or polished or pricey. They just needed to be clean and ready. It's like the dishes you have in your cupboard. You don't put them back there, hopefully not dirty, but you wash them and you put them there so that they're ready whenever you want to use them. And the Bible refers to us as vessels of God's choosing that are purified and prepared and ready to be used for His honor. I think it's amazing how often God's word talks about holiness, and yet we still misunderstand that holiness is not just a matter of do's and don'ts. It's not just what you avoid or abstain from. But holiness is not a passive prospect. It is a purposeful pursuit. It's something that we go after. The Bible describes David as a man after God's own heart. And David describes his own passion in terms of running after God's commands. He's going for it with God and following those things because he realized that it wasn't some restrictive burden to obey God, but instead it was a path to freedom. Because obeying God not only aligns us with God's purposes, but it puts us right in the center of the action. Whatever God's doing, wherever He's going, we're right there with Him if we're pursuing holiness in our lives. And when we're pursuing the invaluable treasures of God's kingdom, we're going to leave a lot of worthless junk behind. Because if my life and my time and energies are going to be swallowed up by anything, I want it to be a hunger for God. If my life is going to be consumed by something, I want it to be a passion for the one that the scripture describes as a consuming fire, a fire that purifies and prepares my life for whatever God intends. And that's the second aspect of consecration that I want to bring out. And that is purity, being spiritually clean on the inside. And that's what happens when we first repent and turn to God and receive His forgiveness in the first place, as He cleanses us from sin. But because God takes us as we are, there's a lot of things that still need to be worked out in our lives. And that's where the term sanctification comes in. You know, the old time Pentecostals used to refer to believers as saved and sanctified. And it's the same term as holy. Being sanctified implies an ongoing process of that growth and maturity by which God refines us and prepares us and ultimately involves us in His plans. And that's a purifying process. And it's not always a pleasant process. And though God's Spirit is the ultimate cleaning agent, again, we also have a significant role to play in keeping our lives free from impurity. And much of that has to do with what we take in through our senses, what we watch and look at, what we listen to, what we think about, what we talk about, both good and bad. And again, it's not just a matter of what we refrain or abstain from. Purity also is a positive thing. And if we're giving our time and attention to constructive and encouraging and beneficial things, then we're not going to have time to waste on worthless things. In Jeremiah chapter 2, God comes to Jeremiah young in his life, and He tells him to deliver a message to people who are far beyond, they were well beyond the point of no return, and God knew it. And He called Jeremiah, and He said, I want you to talk to them, and I want you to tell them what it was that they strayed so far from Me. And the reason they did, it says, because they followed worthless idols. Now, we can look at a passage like that, and we don't bow down to images of wood and stone, but there are plenty of things in our lives that get set up and begin to push God aside, begin to take priority, begin to be God's substitutes, and those things are worthless idols. And the Bible said that when they followed those worthless idols, that they became worthless themselves. Essentially, it's what God's purposes were concerned. They had no effect. And that's why they fell away. Now, I worked with youth for quite a number of years. And man, how many times I heard questions like, well, Pastor Kerry, what's wrong with it? You know, what's wrong with, you know, listening to this kind of music? What's wrong with going to these kind of play? What's wrong with dressing this way? What's wrong with, you know, how far is too far? And all these things. I said, dudes, you're asking the wrong question. It's as if we're trying to see how close we can get to the edge without toppling over. We need to start looking at things and saying, is there anything right with this? And if it really doesn't have any benefit at bringing me closer to God or bringing anyone else closer to God, then it's time to just start lopping off some of those worthless things like it talks about in Hebrews chapter 12, so we can begin to run that race and go after God freely and pursue His purposes. You know, Christians get so obsessed with avoiding legalism, which is about putting conditions on salvation, and that should be rejected. But most of the issues that Scripture cites as examples of legalism, like certain traditions or circumcision or even certain foods, those are all outward things, or at the very most, things we take in and they go out. But the Bible deals in a completely different way with things that get into our minds and affect our spirits, because those things can defile us. Those things can compromise our purity. And that certainly applies to things we watch or listen to or think about. And the Bible repeatedly tells us there's no place for even a hint of ungodliness in those kind of things. In Leviticus chapter 10, verse 10, the Bible talks about knowing the difference between the holy and the common. It doesn't say the difference between the holy and the totally profane and vile and ungodly. It just simply says the common. Things that are normal and accepted to most people, because most of the things that are commonly accepted in the world are not suitable for God's people. And that's why he tells us to come out and be separate. Not that we lose touch with people who need to know him, but so that we resist getting caught up in the world system, the world's way of thinking and the world's way of doing things, the things that society promotes and prioritizes, because the way we live needs to be distinct. Our lives should stand out and our priorities should be different. And that's the third thing I want to mention, is our priorities. Because it's easy to say that God comes first, but what actually gets your time and attention and energy? What occupies your thoughts? What are your passions? What excites you the most? Because chances are that's going to control you the most. We can say that God is number one, but our lifestyle tells a quite a different story if we give greater attention to our hobbies and entertainment than we do to God's word and prayer and serving his purposes. And I'm not saying you got to be spending 3 or 4 hours a day in prayer, but are the things that we're up to, even the things he calls us to take care of, our family and relationships, are we doing those things God's way? Because even when we're serving God's purposes, I think I find myself a lot of times doing things that I think are important rather than what God knows is important. You might remember the story of Mary and Martha when Jesus entered their home, very close friends of Jesus while on earth. And they were both very godly women, but Martha was concerned about a lot of things. And Jesus was in the room there talking to his disciples. And Martha says to the Lord, she says, "Lord, tell my sister to help me. I got a lot of things going on here." And Jesus said, "Man, Martha, you're worried about a lot of things in life, but only one thing's really needed. And Mary's chosen that one thing, and I'm not going to take it from her." She was just sitting there listening to Jesus, spending time in his presence. And I think even when it comes to the necessities of life, things that God knows we need to take care of, our family and work and relationships, are we handling these things God's way in a way that honors and points people to him? Because we get so preoccupied with our work and entertainment and politics and problems and even legitimate responsibilities. And God understands those things. And he says if we will prioritize his purposes, if we will seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, he will take care of all those other things. He will meet our needs in miraculous ways if necessary. But if we're going to expect God to do great things in the days ahead, and just as he called all of Israel to consecrate themselves, even so, he calls all of his people today, including this devoted Sunday night crowd, to consecrate themselves, to come apart from other things, to get ready for what God wants to do next. Because we may be waiting for God to move, but are we really ready for God to move? Because as the Israelites stood on the banks of the Jordan and they were ready to claim that promise, they were ready to reclaim territory for God. This wasn't a time just to watch and to wait, because yeah, he was going to fight their battles in a miraculous way, just like Pastor talked about last week at Jericho. But there were more battles to win. And today we face a lot of intense battles, not with flesh and blood, but as the scripture describes, against spiritual powers. And spiritual battles need to be fought with spiritual weapons. If you didn't hear my message from about 5 weeks ago, go back and listen to that. It talks about being battle ready. And in that we see that one of the most potent weapons we have, in fact, it's not really so much a weapon as the way we need to do battle, and that is through prayer. And that's the last thing, certainly not the least thing I want to mention. prayer, because prayer is how we learn to discern God's voice, so we can tell the right way from the wrong way, and we can follow His path rather than our own or someone else's. Prayer is how we supernaturally partner with God to advance His kingdom. It's the way we engage the forces of God to overpower the forces of evil. Prayer is how we come into agreement with God and set things in motion in heavenly realms that affect the course of events here on earth. Prayer is how we access God's presence, God's purpose, and God's power. And if we're going to claim God's promise and reclaim His territory, then His presence needs to go before us, which means we need to invite that presence to surround and saturate every aspect of our lives. And that involves consecration. That involves turning our attention away from temporary things and putting our focus on eternal things. Because if we're preoccupied with this world and everything that's going on in, I guarantee you're going to be distracted and fearful and complacent and ultimately ineffective for God. Because every day this world is going harder and faster away from God, which means times are going to get tougher for those who are following Him. So we need to be prepared. And God said He's going to sustain us, and He said He's ultimately going to give us the victory. But our faith to receive that promise needs to be evident in our willingness to take up the challenge of doing battle through prayer. If you haven't heard my last message 3 weeks ago, it was the last one we recorded before we started coming together on Sunday night. It's entitled, "The Time Is Now." And it speaks to where we are as a nation and what we need to begin to do as God's people. It focuses on 2 Chronicles 7:14, that if my people who are not my preachers, not my prophets, if my people, if my church will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven and I will forgive their sins and I will heal their land. Man, our land needs healing. There's no doubt about that. But healing in the land starts with prayer in the church. And we need to get ready for what's ahead. And we need to follow Him through it. I'd ask the musicians to come and just begin to play something behind me. Joshua chapter 3, verse 9. Joshua said to the Israelites, "Come and hear and listen to the words of the Lord your God. This is how you will know that the living God is among you, and that He will certainly drive out before you the Canaanites, Hittites, Hivites, all the ites. See, the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord of the earth will go into the Jordan ahead of you." Again, the Ark representing the presence of God going ahead of them. In verse number 14, "So when the people broke camp to cross the Jordan, the priests carrying the Ark of the Covenant went ahead of them." Now, the Jordan is at flood stage during the harvest. You know, a lot of times people try to discount the miracles in Scripture, like there was something else going on here. You know, the river is about dry and they're going through maybe in a few puddles and that. This was at flood stage. And yet it says that the waters from upstream stopped flowing when the priest's feet touched the water's edge. And the priests who carried the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord stopped in the middle of the Jordan and stood on dry ground while all of Israel passed by until the whole nation had completed crossing on dry ground. Now, I'm not even going to get into chapter 4 because it says that right after they crossed, the first thing that Joshua instructed was for them to take 12 stones from the middle of the river that they had just crossed, from the heart of the thing that stood in their way, for the thing that could have overwhelmed them had they not been led by God's presence, and to erect those things as a memorial so that when future generations saw this and said, "What's all this about?" they could tell them exactly what God had done for them. And that's what it says in verse 24. It says, "He did this so that all the peoples of the earth might know that the hand of the Lord is powerful, so that you might always fear the Lord your God." That's what our world needs to see. They need to see God's power happening through His people. And I look at this and say, what can we learn from Israel's crossing into the promised land? Well, if you don't want the floodwaters of life to overwhelm you, follow God's presence. If you want to receive what God has in store for you, then follow His presence. If you want to see victory over the things that oppose you and stand in your way and have held you back, then follow God's presence into the river. If you want to be in the center of His purpose and experience His power, then follow God's presence. If you want to see His promises fulfilled and leave a legacy that's worth following, a witness to anyone who might ask, "What is all this about?" then pursue God's presence in such a way that your faith in His power is undeniable. And it all starts with learning to recognize God's presence and discern His voice by taking time to listen to Him in prayer. You want answers and direction? Pastor Austin said this a few times. Get into the Word. That's where you'll find it. You want to learn to discern God's voice? Then get into prayer and move out in faith as you sense His presence going ahead of you. And I'm saying, don't just sit back and wait for God to fulfill His promise and prophecies in this last days, because those who aren't prepared are going to miss it. And the ark of God's presence begins to move, just like the Israelites. We need to move with it, because we're going places we've never gone before. And the days ahead, we're going to begin to experience things, both trials and triumphs, that we've never seen before. And I can't tell you what's going to happen. There are a lot of dire predictions out there, and there's some hopeful ones as well. But I believe in the days ahead that we're going to begin to see the greatest revival that the world has ever known. But that's going to go right alongside with some of the greatest persecution that God's people have ever experienced. And those things are going to go hand in hand, and they're going to run a parallel course right through the heart of the church. And we better be ready for both. Because the Bible says in the last days that there's going to be a great sifting and a great shaking. And only those things that are on solid footing of faith are going to stand. And we're not going to be able to ride the fence. We're not going to be able to be lukewarm. Because if you are, you're going to be swept away by the delusion that's already engulfing this world. And I don't know about you, but I don't want to be like the people who came to the brink of the promised land that first time and didn't trust God to drive out the giants before them. And because of their disobedience, they never entered that land of promise. Because I can tell you, before we ever received that promise, before we ever reclaim territory for God, before we ever leave a legacy for a world that's lost and hurting and needs Him, then we need to consecrate ourselves. Because in the days ahead, God is preparing to do some powerful things through those who are ready. And so tonight is a night to consecrate ourselves. I want you all to stand with me. Maybe the point we're at right now is like they were that first time at the river. And our willingness to prepare or unwillingness to prepare, to obey God, to take action, is going to determine whether we receive the promise or whether it passes to others. Because the fact is, today is a day of consecration. We're going to take time tonight, and you've got plenty of time. I've got plenty of time to pray. And I don't know what it is that you need to consecrate tonight, what you may need to come away from, what you need to prepare for. Only God knows that. We're going to have time. We want to spend time seeking Him. In the days ahead, we're going to be doing a lot more of this in Sunday night service and other contexts. And we've got some things we believe are from God, some plans to really make this a place immersed in prayer so that people know that something is going on here and God is up to something. Those are the plans. But now begins the preparation. And I don't know what it is you might need to come away from so you can draw near to God, or what could be standing between you and God's promise. I don't know what might be in your life that's gained too much influence and maybe begin to take priority over the things of God and His passion and purpose. I can't tell you specifically what you need to concentrate, but God will show you if you're willing to pray like the psalmist did in chapter 139, verse 23. It says, "Search me, God, and know my heart. Test me and know my anxious thoughts. See if there is any offensive way in me, and lead me in the way everlasting." So tonight, my challenge is to all of us to ask God to search our hearts, to reveal any self-centered ambition, any impurity, any misguided priority, any motive or intention or attitude that's not quite right, so He can create in us a clean heart and purify and prepare us for whatever He wants to do in through us. Last week, Pastor talked right after this happened, and they crossed the river, and Joshua encountered an angelic being, and he said, "Are you for us or against us?" And he said, "Neither," which was kind of a curious answer, because he identified himself as a captain of the armies of heaven. I said, wouldn't he have been for them? And Pastor pointed out, the issue in that thing wasn't whether God is with us. The issue is, are we on God's side? Are we with Him? The real question is, are we following His presence? Are we aligned with His plans? Don't just ask God to go with you and to bless your plans and efforts and intentions. Be sure you're listening to His voice and pursuing His purposes and letting Him prepare you for what's ahead. And then, just like those in Joshua's time, we're not going to see defeat. So tonight, Whatever it is that God wants to deal with you, and maybe this morning, if you're just message, you already let God deal with you maybe for some sin in your life, and maybe there's still some things that need to be worked out, and you need to wrangle a bit with that. Or maybe there's things you know that God's got a purpose you. Maybe you already kind of know what that is, and you need to kind of work that out. I don't know what it is, and you need to tonight come away from or set aside of or get ready for what God wants to do. Only God can tell you that. There's nothing really anything more I can say to prepare you for tonight or to prepare you for what's ahead. Because what I could say in a whole lot of words might challenge or inspire you for a few moments. But what God says to you in just a few words or no words at all can change you forever. And so tonight is a night of consecration. I just want you to begin to find a place here. You want to come down to these altars, this place that represents a place of encounter with God all throughout Scripture. You do that and find a place. If you want to kneel or sit right where you're at, do that. Some of you may, like me, I tend to like walk and pace and whatever, but we've got the time tonight because this is more important business than anything I can do. I just need to be quiet and let God alone speak to you. And so that's what we're going to do tonight. Would you find a place tonight and say, God, what is it in me that you need to consecrate? Because I want to be ready for what you want to begin in my life tomorrow.